This peak, which is currently in an arid environment in West Texas, represents an ancient marine reef ecosystem. I'm at Guadalupe Mountains National Park, and in this video, I'm going to be going through the geologic history of this region, as well as the ecosystems that used to inhabit it, as we hike to the highest point in Texas.
Before we jump right into the geology, I have to apologize in advance because I went into this hike assuming I'd film everything for this video on location, but the wind ended up getting to over 60 miles an hour, and on top of that, we came in the middle of a winter, and although the base of the mountain wasn't that cold, it was far below freezing at the top, and with the wind on top of that, it was just insane conditions. All the shrubs at the top were frozen. My mouth was numb. The wind was hitting us like crazy. I have a few clips that I'll put at the end in the outtakes where I nearly was falling over because of the wind. You can't really hear it because my mic's connected and my mic does a great job of cutting out the wind, but oh my gosh, you guys, it was insane. And because my mouth was frozen and numb, it became quite comical for me to try and speak on camera. And you will see some clips in this video where you can tell my mouth is not moving normally and I do not sound normal, and that is why. But anyway, that's why this video is largely voiceover with lots of B-roll. So I hope you'll, you know, be okay with that. But anyway, let's get back to the geology of these mountains and what clips that I was able to get.
For this story, we start 260 million years ago during the Permian period, when this region was submerged beneath a vast shallow sea called the Delaware Basin, which is part of the larger Permian Basin. This warm tropical marine system was made possible by the assembly of the supercontinent Pangaea.
Tectonic activity associated with the formation of Pangaea created a deep enclosed depression perfect for reef-building organisms.
Perhaps the most impressive feature of this ancient sea was the Capitan Reef.
But unlike modern coral reefs, the Capitan Reef was primarily composed of sponges, algae, bryozoans, and other microorganisms. These organisms built a massive horseshoe-shaped reef that extended for over 400 miles.
And fun fact, this reef is one of the best preserved fossil reef systems in the world. And this makes it an incredible resource for geologists studying ancient ecosystems.
Other marine organisms, including brachiopods, gastropods, ammonites, and crinoids are also beautifully preserved in the limestone. These fossils give us insight into the diversity of life that thrived during the Permian.
And remember, these creatures lived in a time before dinosaurs had even appeared.
These fossils also tell us about the environmental conditions of the time, like water temperature, pH, salinity, and even oxygen levels. This is because some of these organisms only lived under certain temperature, pH, salinity levels, and oxygen concentrations. So measuring their abundance and distribution can give us an idea of these conditions and how they varied spatially and temporally across the basin.
But we can also measure the composition of ancient shell fossils to make our environmental reconstructions even more precise.
This is because marine organisms' shells or skeletons form from chemicals in the ambient water. And when we measure the composition of these shells, we can get information about the chemistry of the water in which they formed.
And really quick, I just wanted to stop for a second to discuss some of the fossils I got video of in this ancient reef, because what they represent is way cooler than I think they're given credit for.
Now, the fossils I saw include many groups like various types of sponges, coral groups, mollusks, brachiopods, algae, and other microbes. But these rice-shaped ones in particular are so cool, because believe it or not, these were single-celled organisms called fusilinids. Yep, single-celled. I tried to include my boots or my hand in some of the shots to show scale, but just for context, some of these got up to the size of my pinky finger almost. A single-celled organism. Now, it wasn't their cell per se that got this large, but their test or shell. These organisms, these fusilinids, built a shell. They're extinct now, but foraminifera, the group that they belonged to, still exists. And if you go to a carbonate beach, you're bound to find some. But these fusilinids built a shell kind of around their cell that we call a test, which could get a lot larger than their cell itself. And this is what got preserved. This is what got so large. And I just think this is something that's so cool, and hardly anybody talks about how cool these organisms are. Now, there are many fusilinids. If you find these somewhere in the field other than here, they are typically a lot smaller, like the size of a rice grain. But these ones got just huge. And I tried to justify it and be like, there's no way these are fusilinids. They're way too big. You know, I thought maybe they're some sort of algae. Maybe they're piezoids, which are kind of like oooids, like, you know, spherical or oval type shaped nodules that actually form around a nucleus that may or may not have been organic in these types of carbonate reef settings. However, when I zoom in on the video I got, it's clear that there's internal structure in these rice-shaped giant likely fusilinid fossils that indicate fusilinids. I really think they were. And that is just insane to me that they could have gotten so big as single-celled organisms. Anyway, we go on.
As the Permian period came to an end, tectonics began to reshape the landscape once again. The Delaware Basin began to dry up, leaving behind vast evaporites or salt deposits. And over millions of years, these sediments were buried and compacted.
Finally, around 20 to 30 million years ago, over 200 million years later, tectonic activity associated with the formation of the Basin and Range Province in western North America uplifted the Capitan Reef and surrounding sediments, leading to the Guadalupe Mountains we love today. Now, Guadalupe Peak, which is part of this ancient reef complex, is the tallest point in Texas at 8,751 feet.
Another part of this ancient reef system is El Capitan, a striking limestone cliff that represents the exposed edge of this ancient reef. El Capitan is a paleontologist's dream because it not only exposes the reef structure, but also so many of the fossils of the organisms that lived in and around the reef. And what's even more amazing is that these layers of rock aren't like the Grand Canyon, where each layer represents a time period millions of years after the one before it. Rather, all these rocks represent the same time period. They're all Permian age, around 260 to 270 million years old. So it's incredible that we have all of these rocks preserved from this time. And fun fact, this park is a designated international dark sky park, which means that it has some of the best stargazing opportunities in the country. I'll try to put some clips in if we stay here till dark, but you should really come to experience it yourself, as the camera just doesn't do it justice.
Although I do have to say, if you're planning on doing this hike, do not do it when the forecast is for 60 mile an hour wind. Just a warning.
Lastly, I want to point out that the same geologic processes that formed the Capitan Reef also contributed to the formation of the nearby Carlsbad Caverns. And I'm going to have a video out soon talking all about those amazing caves, so make sure to check that out.
Now, if you're thinking about visiting Guadalupe or Carlsbad, I highly recommend checking out the Roadside Geology books for Texas and New Mexico. They are incredibly helpful when trying to navigate the geology of where you are. And a lot of their geologic maps are marked with roads and markers to help you find out where you are. And that's a big thing, because a lot of geologic maps that you can find online don't necessarily mark roads and stuff, so you can't figure out where the heck you are. So these books are really great. And they even have the Roadside Geology Texas book inside the Guadalupe Mountains National Park gift shop, which I thought was super cool. And with that, guys, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye. And update, we did end up making it to the top of, well, the highest point in Texas, Guadalupe Peak, in what is now the hardest hike I have ever done. Not because of the physical requirements of the hike, but because of the weather, the wind and the cold. Guys, I'm a Texas girl. I grew up in Texas. Hot is what I'm used to. Hot and still and humid. This cold wind, I mean, what is this? Frozen stuff? What is this? I can't. So I'm just going to let this clip where I went to the peak and jumped up and down play for you with the sound on so you can hear just how windy it was. Damn it. Why are we doing this?
Oh no, that's the wrong line. Okay. This will be good B-roll or outtake. This peak, which is currently in an arid environment in West Texas, represents an ancient... Woo! Another good outtake. If you want to come to Guadalupe Mountains when it's windy, don't. Okay. I can't.